Good morning, everyone. Welcome to church. We're glad you could join us this morning. We invite you to stand as we sing our opening song.
Faithfulness, faithfulness.
Amen. Y'all go ahead and have a seat.
Woohoo! That water's cold! You're gonna like it, Mackenzie. It's good. It's refreshing. I like to say it's refreshing. It's not cold. It's all in a state of mind. We are so happy to be here today, being during this service, having a baptism. We're performing both ordinances today. We have baptism and we have communion we're taking at the end of the service. Denver Dennis, I was talking to him earlier, and he said if we had a foot washing, we'd have it all covered. But we're not washing any feet today, sorry. So we're here today to celebrate baptism. This is an outward expression. It's a ceremonial act. It's an outward expression of an inward belief. You're performing an act that says on the inside, I have faith in Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. I have faith, I have hope and trust that Jesus Christ shed his blood on the cross to cover my sin, and by proving his victory over death and the grave and sin and Satan, he's going to give me that gift of eternal life also, and I'm putting my hope and my trust in that. That's what we are saying today by doing this act. This act doesn't save you. This act is an act of obedience. It's an act of obedience saying, this is what I believe, therefore I'm going to do what Jesus has called me to do, and he has called me first to be baptized in his name. So we are excited to do that today. Our first victim is Tiny Chong. Yeah. Well known. Tiny's well known. It's refreshing. It's not cold. It's refreshing.
Yeah.
Tiny. Yeah. Keep telling yourself that. Tiny, is it true that you have repented of your sins and placed your faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior to forgive you of those sins and give you the gift of eternal life?
I do.
By your profession of faith, I baptize you, my brother in Jesus, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, buried in his likeness and raised to newness of life. Walk in newness of life. He told me he was going to take me under with him. I said, I'll hold you down until you stop bubbling. Ladies first, this is Mackenzie Morgan. Mackenzie and Blake and the girls came several weeks ago and wanted to join the church by a profession of faith and a baptism. See, Blake, you were smart to go second. And so anyway, we're here today to perform that act, and so they can officially join the church, and we're excited to do that. So, Mackenzie, is it true that you have repented of your sins, placed your faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior for the forgiveness of those sins and the gift of eternal life?
Yes.
By your profession of faith, I baptize you, my sister, in Jesus, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in his likeness, and raised to walk in newness of life. I tripped over that brick both times today. You want the block?
Yeah.
I'm not going to say anything else. That's why you went last. So, Blake, is it true that you have repented of your sins, placed your faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior for the forgiveness of those sins and the gift of eternal life? I baptize you, my brother, in Jesus, based on that profession, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, buried in his likeness and raised to newness of life. Yeah. I love baptisms. This is as good as scoring touchdowns or better. It makes me fired up. As the worship team comes up, we're going to continue in our worshiping through song, but we're going to have a scripture reading as they're coming up. The words that are in yellow, if you would repeat those with me, if you would recite those with me, we will just continue our worship service this way. For you formed my inward parts. You wove me in my mother's womb. I will give thanks to you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works, and my soul knows it very well. Amen.
Amen. So as we move forward, y'all can go ahead and stand up if you want to. We're gonna stand to sing. But this is the time of our service where we invite you to come forward to pray. We're a church that believes of the power of prayer, and we want to give you the opportunity to pray this morning in the house of the Lord. Also, I want to take just a second and thank you as a church for sending all of us pastors to an amazing conference this week. We had a wonderful time of fellowship and just growing as followers of Christ. And something that we were reminded of while we were at this conference is that Jesus did not create his church to be a set off, standalone to the side entity. He called his church to go, to move into the world and spread his message of salvation, the gospel, the good news, to the ends of the earth. And it's really easy to come into this building and do church and even mean it, but it's just easy to just do it right here. And so, like I said, we were reminded of this calling to go and do, but I wanted to remind you this morning. I want to charge you, encourage you to pray about how our church, how you within our church can move. Not of our own power, but with God's guidance, how we can move into our community and through that into the ends of the earth. And so this morning, if you feel so led, I invite you to come forward and pray specifically about that. How can we reach the lost?
God, my God. Love and pure.
this morning, we stand before you as your people, the people you've called to fulfill your commandments here on earth, Lord. As I said earlier, I'm moved by the thought of what you actually have called us to do as a church. And Lord, right now it is my prayer that we can come together in efforts to go out. That we draw from you and from the love and the encouragement of each other. And in doing so, it emboldens us to speak your name, to profess your glory, and to spread the gospel. Lord, I lift up those right now that have put their lives in danger to bring your name and your message of good news of salvation to those that have never heard it, and in places that it's dangerous to even speak your name. Lord, we thank you for your word that you've given us, that we can look to it, and you speak to us through it, and that through that word you continue to call us into more and more and call us deeper and deeper. And so, Lord, as we prepare to hear your word this morning, Lord, I would just ask that you would hold Daniel up and that you would speak through him. We know you've given him a word this morning, and it's just for this time, just for those that are here that are going to hear it. And we just pray that we would understand, and that we will use what you've given us. Lord, just help us to not put you up on a shelf. Be the God of Sunday mornings, or the God of Wednesday nights. But that you're the God, you're the ruler of our heart day in and day out. You're the God of this creation. Lord, I thank you for a church that loves you. Lord, and we thank you for Jesus. And Lord, we do love you. Let that be seen by those that look inward to us, that we do love you. And because we love you, we love others. We thank you for loving us. Pray these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Go ahead and have a seat, kids. Make your way through the door over here.
Presley sent me a funny video a couple days ago. It said when the kids are released to children's church, and it had a bunch of monkeys and gorillas going crazy. Pretty accurate. Good stuff. Man, God's good, isn't he? God's good. He's been working. I don't know if you've noticed, but he's been working. Today, those three baptisms, that's 15 baptisms since June in our church. I don't know that I remember a few months like that where we've had as many baptisms as we've had since I've been here. It's amazing. It's fun to be a part of it. I do want to remind. I've been meaning to remind you for a couple of weeks. We are working on these floors. We're working on it. It takes time to do anything or get anything done these days. But we will have new floors here pretty soon and new padded pews front, top, bottom, and back soon. So just wanted to. Some of you weren't at the business meeting, didn't know that. All that is being done. It just hasn't happened yet. So I wanted to mention that to you. So this is our last week of Real Talk, and I thought we would just end it nice and smooth, nice and easy. We've had some complicated and some controversial subjects that we've talked through in the last 7 weeks. This is our eighth week, and I thought, well, let's just end it on something easy. Everybody can agree on this. There's nothing harmful or hurtful, or there's no emotions tied to this or anything else. This is an easy subject for us to talk about. So That's why I decided to do that. That's what I do, by the way. Every week, I just pray, God, will you just give me the easiest subject to preach about? Just make it very easy, very comfortable. Make everyone have warm and fuzzies and feel good. God, don't ever step on their toes. Just make it simple. And he just doesn't answer that prayer, guys. I'm sorry. So I don't know what to tell you. So we're looking at abortion this morning to finish this series up. And next week, Dusty will be preaching, Lord willing. So we're looking forward to that. He'll be bringing a word for us next week, and it's going to be good. So as we get ready to dig into this, just a couple of verses today. Eugene Peterson said this quote, "In the presence of birth, we don't calculate, we marvel. In the presence of birth, we don't calculate, we marvel." And if you've never been in the presence of birth, I'm here to tell you, it's one of the most miraculous things you'll ever see in your life. It is an absolute miracle when you see that take place, when you're part of it. I turned into a ball of mush when they put Presley in my hands. I also knew I could murder someone, which is a strange thing to say from the pulpit, I know, but when they put her in my hands, I thought, yeah, I could kill something that hurt this, no doubt about it. That's wrong, but I could still do it, I'm just telling you. It's a marvelous thing. We don't calculate in the presence of birth, we marvel. So there was a professor in a world-acclaimed medical school that once posed this medical situation, and it's an ethical problem to his students. Here's the family history, he said. The father has syphilis, the mother had TB, tuberculosis. They already have had four children. The first one born blind, the second died, the third born deaf, and the fourth was born with tuberculosis. Now the mother is pregnant again. The parents come to you for advice, the professor is telling these students. They are willing to have an abortion if you decide that they should. What do you say to the patients? And the students gave various opinions, and the professor asked them to break into small groups for consultation. All of the groups came back to report that they would, in this circumstance, recommend abortion. And the professor said, "Congratulations, you just took the life of Beethoven." Because that was his family history. And I figured that'd land about as hard as it did. And is accurate for this subject, because it is not an easy subject. And I don't take it lightly. So let's read these few verses, and then we'll dig into this topic. This is in Jeremiah. It says, "Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I have appointed you a prophet to the nations." So we're going to dig into that, but we're going to go through some facts. Now, here's the thing about this subject, and really any subject that's this difficult. You can't change people's minds with facts when it comes to this subject, or any subject that is tied to this much emotion. You will not fact your way into winning this argument. But facts are still important. We do need to have our mind engaged when it comes to this. So just real quick, some early history, okay? This is not a new problem. Abortion didn't become an issue when Roe versus Wade became the law of the land in 1972. That's not when it started, okay? We have evidence in some of the papyruses in Egypt that in 1550 BC, the Egyptians had figured out a way to perform an abortion. This is an age-old problem because it's a man problem, it's a sin problem, it's a difficulty of a sinful world problem. This has been around for a long time. Aristotle wrote this in the 300s BC. "When couples have children in excess, let abortion be procured before sense and life have begun." It was common in the Roman Empire. It was okay to do it in the Roman Empire. This is not a new issue. Now, the legality of abortion is a fairly new issue. That started in the 1800s in this country, where some doctors started fighting against abortion being legal. Some people think it was more because it was so dangerous and so unsafe for the mother that it wasn't about saving children, it was about saving mothers' lives because the procedure, was so dangerous at the time. It was unregulated and not careful. But neither here nor there, in the 1800s is when that started. 1821, Connecticut became the first U.S. state to criminalize abortion, and then it's been up and down and all around ever since then. By 1965, all 50 states had outlawed abortion, with some exceptions varying by states, and then that brought on what we now call Roe versus Wade. That was the Supreme Court case that decided that nationally, that states couldn't make laws that outlawed abortion outright. That's what that court case did. And there's a lot of things that go on with that. A few things. We'll just dig into that just a little bit, not too deep. In 1973, the court outlined in Roe that the state had, quote, an important and legitimate interest in potential life, and that the compelling point is at viability. This is so because the fetus presumably has the capability of meaningful life outside the mother's womb, and it placed that viability around 24 to 28 weeks at the time Roe versus Wade was decided. What does that mean? Why am I saying that? What I'm saying is the court case that made it legal to have an abortion in this country said in the majority opinion that at the point that a child can live outside of the womb, then it is no longer okay to have an abortion. That's what Roe versus Wade said. There's just something that never gets talked about, and why that is the case, I have no idea. But at the time, they thought viability, in other words, the ability of an unborn child to live outside of the mother, was around 24 to 28 weeks. The court also said in that opinion, it observed that some argue that the woman's right is absolute and that she is entitled to terminate her pregnancy at whatever time, in whatever way, and for whatever reason she alone chooses. With this, we do not agree. That is the court's opinion in Roe versus Wade. The court decision that made abortion legal said in the court decision that it is not okay to allow abortion all the way through full term when that first happened. Now, some advocate for that now, but that is not what this law did. It explicitly said that that is not okay. And then in 2021, a columnist, Chris Cunningham, observed that at the time Roe was decided, when that court case took place, 72-73, that babies born younger than 28 weeks could not be expected to survive. Today, babies born before that have a 79% chance of surviving. Many of the Supreme Court justices at the time of Roe versus Wade, right after deciding it, said that it had a time limit on it, that eventually things were going to change, that the decision itself was fundamentally flawed, and some things have changed to make that the case. So that's a little bit of background on that. Then you get to this. In terms of actually viewing the child in the womb, okay, the use of ultrasound has perhaps been the most game-changing technology on this subject, according to Dr. Tara Sander Lee. She was a senior fellow and director of life sciences at Charlotte Lozier Institute. Dr. Lee is also a Harvard-trained scientist who previously directed a research laboratory investigating congenital heart diseases in children. And this is a quote from a Daily Wire article that she said. The black and white dots of an ultrasound before Roe could barely identify the head of an unborn child in the womb, much less identify the heartbeat at 6 weeks, watch the child cry at 15 weeks, suck his thumb, or even cry when receiving an anesthetic injection prior to life-saving surgery in utero. Here's an example of that for the visual people out there. Okay? The picture on the left is what an ultrasound looked like in 1965. Okay? That's twins. I'm pretty sure you couldn't tell that, but that's what it is. That's the heads of two twins in 1965. And then this is a more modern picture of what ultrasounds look like. Those of you that have done those recently, you know, like the 4D ultrasounds now are unbelievable. I mean, I've given a similar message like this to the youth back in May of 22, right around the time that Roe versus Wade was, everything was going crazy about that, and we talked about it then. And I said then about this picture, it reminds me of when we got Presley's 4D ultrasound. You know what Presley's 4D ultrasound looked like? Like Presley. I remember thinking that when they put her in my hands. I was like, wow, that looks like the picture. That's unbelievable. How can they do that? Modern ultrasound technology lets us see with our eyes what both science and our hearts have long known, which is the undeniable humanity of the unborn child. Dr. Lee said that. Science confirms and ultrasound shows that unborn babies respond to touch and taste just like you and me. They feel excruciating pain, with fully formed noses and lips, eyes and eyebrows, fingers and toes. They explore the world around them, and with advancements in surgical techniques, unborn babies are even treated inside the womb like any other patient from as early as 15 weeks. Now, Ashley McGuire said this, when you're seeing a baby sucking its thumb at 18 weeks, smiling, clapping, it becomes harder to square the idea that the 20-week-old, that unborn baby or fetus, is discardable. An oft-repeated line from pro-choice advocates is that the baby is just a clump of cells and nothing more. However, the ultrasound shows that the abortion lobby's tired old argument is just simply a lie, Dr. Lee said in this article. It's just a lie. It's just not true. Continuing with facts, and then we'll hit some emotions. Abortion is increasingly concentrated among the poor. If you can't see those statistics, the blue is 1 to 2 times above federal poverty level, which would mean you would be qualified for free and reduced lunch in the school, and the red is below federal poverty level. So if you look at those numbers, 75% of women, and this is a 2014 stat, it's probably gotten worse, 75% of women that got an abortion would be lower income women. That tells you a lot about the situation and about what's taking place in this. Another stat. These are by racial lines. And I won't get bogged down here, but I could. I could get really fired up and I could start throwing historical stuff at you. But if you look at this line, the bottom line, the green line, that is white non-Hispanic. It's the rate of abortion in that ethnic group has stayed about the same. Okay. And then the top line is black non-Hispanic. This is abortions per 1,000 women aged 15 to 44. This is a 2014 stat. So 10 per 1,000 on the white. In 2000, it was up near 50 per 1,000 for black non-Hispanic. The blue, the light blue is Hispanic, and the purple is other non-Hispanic. What's the point in that? Don't miss the fact that the highest rate of abortion takes place among minorities. Many would argue that that was the whole point in the first place of pushing Planned Parenthood and things like that, was to keep the rate of minorities as low as possible. That's a hard thing to hear, but it's true. I'll put it this way. If you take those statistics and extrapolate them out from 1972 to today, how many more minority people, black especially, would be alive in this country? It wouldn't be 13% black in this country anymore if abortion wasn't legal. There's no telling how high it would be. In my opinion, that's the motivation of a lot of pro-choice people, which I don't consider pro-choice. I say it's pro-abortion. So that's what it is. I think that's a lot of their motivation. Now, it's covered in a lot of flowery language that sounds really compassionate and sounds really nice, but I think that's a lot of the motivation behind that. I could be wrong, but that's my personal opinion. Here's the long-term U.S. abortion rates. And at the very side over here is after Roe versus Wade. You can see that it peaks around 1991 at about 1.5 million abortions that year in the United States. And it has consistently gone down until 2020. It ends at 2020. There was a slight uptick in 2020 of abortions, about 930,000 legally induced abortions in the United States in 2020. Those statistics are hard to get because some states don't report, so the CDC doesn't count those states, and then other organizations like Guttmacher, they estimate based on the rate of the country, and that's Guttmacher's Institute's statistic, 930,000 in 2020. That means 20.6%, 1 in 5 of all pregnancies in the United States end in abortion. 1 in 5 in the United States end in abortion. It's hard to believe. At this point in time, things have changed a lot in the last 20 years on the mindset of the American culture. 61% of Americans believe abortion should be legal all or most of the time. In some of the most recent polls, that was not the case even 5 years ago, much less 10, 15, 20 years ago. A couple more for my nerds. This chart gives the reason for abortion by percentage. I know it's hard to see, But those of you that are close can. If you're in the balcony, that's why you shouldn't sit in the balcony. I've been trying to tell you all for decades. I'm just kidding. It's okay. So the top one there, 25%, the reason for abortion, not ready for a child. Just not ready for a child. Second one, can't afford a child. Third one, have completed childbearing. In other words, I just don't want to have kids anymore. I feel like it's maybe dangerous, or I just don't want to have a child at this age. The fourth one, don't want to be a single mother. The next one, not mature enough to raise a child. The next one, would interfere with education and career. Okay? So the vast majority of the percentages there, that's 25, 23, 19, 8, 7, 4, and 4, respectively. If you put that together, that means that the vast majority of abortions that take place in this country are elective abortions done for convenience. When I mean convenience, I mean for whatever reason. All those reasons are reasons of convenience. In other words, it's too hard for me to have the child, so I don't want to have the child. That's the reasoning for the vast majority of it. If you look at the next to the bottom one that says, was a victim of rape, 0.5%. 0.5% of abortions that take place in this country were performed because of rape. Now, that statistic's probably a hair higher than that because not everybody would admit that they were a victim of rape. So even if you double it or triple it, it's still only 1.5% of abortions that take place. I've got some more, but that's enough because you're starting to glaze over. Here's you an idea of pro-life versus pro-choice. So the blue is pro-choice. The black is pro-life. You can see that it has varied quite a bit through the last 20 years, stayed fairly similar. It's about a 50-50 issue in our culture. It goes back and forth, but it's about a 50-50 issue, which is why I think politics loves it, personally, because it's an easy one to divide people on. And then last one. This is a year post-Dobbs. Dobbs was the case that overturned Roe versus Wade. In 2022. So this is the rates with how many abortions took place in each state after that went into effect, okay? So what are we saying here? That there were nearly 117,000 more abortions in states where it remained legal in the 12 months following the Dobbs decision, but about 115,000 fewer abortions in the states with a total ban or a 6 weeks ban in effect. So what does that mean? So the darker brown, the yellowish states, their rates of abortions went way down, and the darker the purple, those states went higher. Why is that? Because people from those other states where it was banned went to those states that allowed it to happen and still had it happen. So what am I saying? What I'm saying is Roe versus Wade hadn't done squat. That's what I'm saying. Overturning that law has not done a single thing. The rate of abortions has stayed the same. If anything, by those statistics, there was 2,000 more than there were. So is that a good thing? No, not to my opinion. But my point is, just because Roe versus Wade was overturned, this is not over with, like some people think it is. Like that was just the beginning of this discussion and what to do about it. So keep all that in mind. That's for the people that really need things in their head. And back to Jeremiah. Jeremiah was the son of a priest. His birthplace was Anathoth, which is about 3.5 miles north of Jerusalem. It's a city that was specifically set aside by Joshua as a priestly city. It was close to Jerusalem, and the priests would have made the short journey to the city as required in order to perform their priestly duties on the regular. In the normal course of events, Jeremiah would have exercised the priestly office in due time. He would have become a priest. His father was a priest. He was born in the line of Aaron. He was a Levite. He would have become a priest. But instead, the Lord interrupted that and called him to be a prophet, a thing in which no Old Testament person ever wanted to be. Why? Because nobody likes being the person that says, hey, you need to stop sinning or God's going to punish us. It's not very much fun, to be perfectly honest. The phrase, the word of the Lord came to him, is a typical way of speaking about a prophet's call in the Old Testament. It shows how the prophetic mission was sought by no one who it came to. Rather, God chooses the person for his purpose. His will, once revealed, required that Jeremiah yield himself wholly to it. His whole life would be affected by this call deeply. His prophetic ministry lasted for over 40 years, from 627 BC in the 13th year of Josiah's reign over Judah to 58 or 586, excuse me, BC, in the 11th year of Zedekiah's reign, when Judah was exiled to Babylon after being defeated by the Babylonians. Now, 1 Chronicles talks a little bit about Jeremiah continuing to minister even after the exile, but Jeremiah's book does not. It stops at the exile. And it began like this for Jeremiah in verse 4. Said, "Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, and before you were born, I consecrated you. I have appointed you a prophet to the nations." Before I formed you in the womb is how he starts it. Now, why does he start that way? Not to chase a rabbit, but because Jeremiah doesn't want to be a prophet. And just like Moses, the first thing he says is, "Lord, I can't talk good and I'm too young." He starts giving excuses. You ever done that to God? I haven't, you bunch of sinners. You ought to be ashamed of yourselves. We've all done that. We read these guys and go, but we do the exact same thing. So God says, "Before I formed you in the womb," yatsar is the Hebrew word there for form. That word is used about 60 times in the Old Testament. Its first use is in Genesis 2:7. "Then the Lord God formed man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being." God formed the first man, and he's been doing the same ever since. He formed the first one, and he's forming all the ones that were born today, that will be born today. Yatsar, it's a cool word. It means to form, to fashion, to frame, to make for a purpose or for a utility. This word is used in the making of man, not in the making of woman. I'll get to that in a second. It's often used of a potter forming the clay into a pot, so taking dirt and making it into something useful. Catch that? Just like the Lord formed Adam out of dust into something useful for his will. So there's a utility in the forming of man. I think it's why guys like that kind of stuff so much. We like to make things and make things useful, and we like to feel useful. I think God put that into us from the very beginning. The side note is Eve, woman, it's a different word. Bana. This has nothing to do with today. It's just cool. So you're welcome. Bana. It means to build. There's still a utility in the use of that word. There's still a utility, but there is an eye for the artistic, for the beauty in this word, in the building of woman. It's neat to me that the language from the very beginning shows us that man and woman are different. So God forms, and before he formed Jeremiah, he says, "I knew you." He formed you and me and Jeremiah and everyone else. Before he even started, he says, "I knew you." He knew him before I formed you. Yatsar is the Hebrew word, I knew, the root. I knew you. This isn't just knowing about something like information, like I know information. It's much, much deeper than that. This word is much deeper than that. Hebrew is really cool language. "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you." Yada or yatsar is the root. This is intimate knowledge. Same word used in Genesis 3:5. In fact, God knows, same word, that when you eat it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God, knowing, same word, good and evil. And it goes even deeper than that, the meaning of this word and how it's used. Genesis 4:1, Adam was intimate with his wife, and she conceived and gave birth to Cain. Cain, same word. This is how well God knows you. The same word for knowing Jeremiah is the same word for Adam physically knowing his wife, having sex, being intimate with his wife. He knows her. This is how well God knows you. He knows everything about you. He knows every inch of you because he formed you. Say formed. He formed you. That's why he knows you so well. And he says that he did this before you were born. He made a double emphasis here. He reiterates, before you were born. Literally in the Hebrew, it says, before you came forth out of the womb. The coming forth is a derivation of yatsar, to be formed. So to come forth out of the womb is a conjugation off the word yatsar, meaning the same thing, where he formed him in the womb, and then to come forth out of the womb, it's the same word. It's kind of neat that that is the case. God is making it as clear as he possibly can. He knows you. He knows you. He knows it all. Before you drew breath, he knows you, and he loves you. And then he says this, I consecrated you. That's a cool word. I consecrated you. I set you apart. I planned something special for you, Jeremiah. Don't miss me with your tired excuses, Jeremiah. I knew who you were going to be before you ever even became a thing, before you were ever even an inkling in your daddy's eye. I knew who you were going to be, Jeremiah. I consecrated you. I set you apart. I have a plan for you. Kodesh, to consecrate, to sanctify, to prepare, to dedicate, to be hallowed, to be holy, to be sanctified, to be separate. He's got a plan. He set you apart for it. He wants you to complete this consecrated calling on your life, just like he did Jeremiah's. And then to make sure that he knew that he actually does have a plan, he says, I have consecrated you because I have appointed you to be a prophet to the nations. I have a work for you to do. It's not up to you to decide, Jeremiah, or anyone here listening today. It's not up to you to decide if you're good enough. That has no bearing on God's plans, whether you think you're good enough for what God's calling you to do. It's not part of it. It has nothing to do with whether you think it's the right time. God, that sounds all right, but it's just not really the right time for me. I had a different plan. I was kind of planning on doing this and going here, not going over there. Matter of fact, God, it doesn't even really make sense. People will call me foolish. People will call me foolish, Lord. It doesn't make sense to me. You're not good enough, and it's never the most logical time to do what God is calling you to do. You'll never be good enough, and it will never make logical sense. When God calls, you're not going to go, yeah, you know what? That just makes good sense. Matter of fact, I think I was born for this. I don't think that's what you're going to think. I've never thought that whenever I felt God place a call on my life. You know what I felt? Terror. Scared to death. Ain't no way. I remember telling Brother Clayton, I think God is calling me to full-time ministry and wants me to be the youth pastor and the worship pastor, and that can't be the truth. That cannot be right, so please tell me I'm wrong. I cannot do that. I remember saying those exact words right back there. Brother Clayton didn't listen either. He was no help whatsoever. God is reminding Jeremiah. He said, hey, bud, I'm in charge. You can do this because this is exactly what I formed you to do. This is why I formed you in your mother's womb. This was my plan for you before you drew breath. So get busy doing it, dude. That's the summarization of the next several verses. Just be quiet. Get busy. Go to work. I don't want to hear it anymore. A little more loving than that. A little more theological. But pretty close. So what are these verses and many other places in Scripture? We could go to many other places in Scripture. What are they reminding us? What is the universal truth here, whether it's Jeremiah or you or me or whomever? What is the universal truth being put forward here? It is this. Life is designed and created by God. He owns it, and as such, only he has the right to authorize its taking. End of story. End of story. God is the author of life, and as the author of life, he is the only one that has the authorization for it to be taken. And he's given some authorizations for life to be taken. He has done that. But an innocent child developing inside of a mother, I've never seen that in Scripture where he says that's okay. I've seen him say, defend the defenseless. I've seen him say that. I've never seen him say, well, I understand. You know, my moral laws, they're pretty inconvenient. So, you know, if you don't feel like it, if it's going to inconvenience you a little bit, if it's going to make your life hard, well, you know, I mean, Jesus prayed the same thing to me. Lord, this is going to be really hard. Please take this cup away from me if there's any other way. And, you know, I said, you know what? You're right. You don't have to go to the cross. It's going to be too hard. Is that what it says? I missed that verse. I missed that chapter. I missed that gospel. I didn't see that in there. Well, what about this, preacher? Let's talk about some whatabouts. Some things that are difficult. Some things that are really difficult, actually. Some of you are going to be mad at me by the time I finish this section. That's okay. Well, it's not right to impose your religious beliefs on someone else. That's definitely an argument for this. It's not right to impose your religious beliefs on someone else. So, okay, well, I don't murder because God says it's not what I'm not supposed to do. I don't steal because God says I'm not supposed to steal. Is that imposing my religious beliefs? I believe I'm supposed to help the down and out, the poor of this world. I haven't seen a single person that doesn't want my religious beliefs imposed on someone because of abortion saying, no, don't help that guy. You can't help the poor. That's imposing your religious beliefs. God's the only one that's ever done that, by the way. God's the only one that says, hey, you know what you ought to do? You ought to stop accumulating stuff and help that guy. God's the one that does that. But nobody has a problem with that. Only on this issue. So, throw that one out. Illogical, doesn't work. A woman should have the right to control her own body. That's a tough one. A woman should have the right to control her own body. That's true. I agree. A woman should have the right to control her own body. That's true. But my right to swing my arm stops where your nose begins. Right? Hey, I have a right to throw a punch. It's my body. I can do it if I want to. Well, you don't have a problem with the law saying I can't punch you in the nose for no reason. Even though sometimes you... I'm just kidding. I'll stop. Here's the thing. This is science. A zygote. A fertilized egg. When a sperm and a egg come together, it is a zygote. A zygote is a fertilized egg. It has its own genetic code. It has its own blood type. It has its own organs. It has a different or same, but can be a different sex than the mother. All that happens at the moment of conception. All the DNA is there. All the genetic code is there. Everything is there. From the very beginning, that is a different human being. We recognize that and admit that in any other species. But for some reason, this one gets twisted up to say that's not true. In the developing human, clinically oriented embryology, which is a textbook by Keith L. Moore and T. Persuade, they state a zygote is the beginning of a new human being. The zygote will go through numerous stages of development, but its fundamental identity never changes from what it began as, a new member of the human species, from the textbook. So I agree. Women do have the right to say what happens to their body, as do men. But a child growing inside a mother is not the mother's body. It's a different kid. It's a different person. It's a different human being. Okay? This is landing about as softly as I thought it would. What about this one? Women will die from illegal abortions. If we just make abortion illegal across the board, they're still going to have abortions, and then they're going to be unsafe, illegal abortions. Women still die from abortions now. That's a side note. As far as lethality, it's a fairly safe procedure. There's many health complications that come from it. 30% of abortions end in pelvic infection. But people still die from legal abortions now. The rate's not very high. It's about 4 or 5 per thousand, but it does happen. But think about this argument. Well, if we make this law, then people that break this law will be harmed. Well, people may die from illegal drug deals also. So I guess we should just make that legal. So that won't happen. I mean, they'll still die, but it won't be from an illegal drug deal. Prior to Roe versus Wade in 1973, roughly 90% of illegal abortions were performed by licensed physicians in good standing with their state medical boards. The idea that the vast majority of abortions that took place before Roe versus Wade were in the back alley somewhere with a coat hanger is just not fact. It's a great talking point to get someone emotional and off the debate, but it's just not true. And then this one, and this is the hardest one. Abortion is necessary in cases of rape. Abortion is necessary in cases of rape. Again, 0.5%. If you do the math, that's around 35,000 abortions, if you extrapolate that out from the 650,000 to 690,000 abortions that take place, most of which largely take place for convenience. But that's still 32,000 to 35,000 abortions. That's not nothing. That's still a lot. If that was your daughter or your granddaughter, that one out of the 35,000 would really matter to you a lot. This is a hard one. It's an emotional subject. It's a difficult subject. But here's where I've come on this, and it's taken me a long time to get here. When you say abortion is wrong, except for in the cases of rape, what you're really saying is you had sex when you weren't supposed to, so now you got to live with the consequences. You're not saying that the life matters. You're not saying that the child that's developing inside that mother matters. That's not what you're saying. You're saying, we told you not to have sex, but you did anyway, so now you're stuck with this kid from your bad choices. But since this one wasn't your fault, it's okay to end the pregnancy. What I'm saying is, either life matters or life doesn't. Either life is to be protected or life isn't to be protected. And I admit that that is a horrible, horrible circumstance that I pray would never happen to anyone. But I think life deserves to live regardless of how it was conceived. And that it makes me a little sick to my stomach to say that, because that's not easy. But I do believe that. God, I hope no one has to experience that. So what do we do? We'll finish here. What do we do? It's a hard subject. What do we do about it? Well, I can tell you a few things. We should have mercy and we should have grace. We should love. I know people who have done this. You probably know people who have done this. You may have helped someone do this. The people in my life that I know that have done this, why did they do it? Because they were scared to death of the circumstances they were in. They were young. And they were scared to death. And they made a decision that at the moment they thought was the right decision. And the ones I've talked to regret it so deeply that it still affects them to this day. Some of them 20, 30, 40 years later, still affects them. So we don't condemn. That's what we don't do. We don't condemn. I don't condemn anyone that has done this. It's not my job and not yours either. What can we do? There's a lot of things we can do. We can volunteer at clinics that help with this. We can give money to places who help with this. Our clinic in Russellville, through our convention, has seen such an uptick in women coming in there since Roe versus Wade was overturned. It's like they don't know what to do now. It's like, well, I can't do that. And so they go to all right, this is the one place I know I can go to. And they're limited on resources, and they're limited on people that can help, and they're limited on money. I mean, there's a lot that we can do, church, but what we can't do is condemn those who have made this mistake. Just like you don't want to be condemned for the mistakes you've made. No difference. No difference. So, if you're going to fight for pro-life, just make sure you're fighting for pro-life and not against people who have done this. There's a big difference in how you approach that. Father, I come to you and I thank you for Jesus. I thank you for a God that took it all. He took it all to the cross, God. All sin, mine and everybody else's that's ever lived, Father. All of it. He paid for all of it with his righteous blood. And I pray that that truth would be the guiding truth to how we treat each other in all circumstances. That we would love in truth and grace with mercy. That we would love each other the way you love us. Thank you, God, for your precious gift. We have no hope without it. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I invite you to stand with us. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Temptations, is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful? Sorrow share. Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in precious Jesus. Lord and friend, I give everything to you. Shelter, shepherd, Savior. Still our refuge. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Do thy friends despise, forsake thee? Take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he'll take and shield thee. Thou wilt find the solace there. Thou wilt find the solace, precious Jesus.